to come up to the dais, please. Mr. Singhdeo and Mr. Partho Sengupta. This is going to be a session of maybe maximum half an hour, 25 minutes or so. The topic is, are we politicizing our natural resources? Very interesting topic, but I'm afraid since time is running out, maybe this topic we can again discuss during the evening time when we meet here. Mr. Kalikesh Narayan Singhdeo is an Indian politician from Orissa and a leader of the Biju Janata Dal political. Prior to becoming an MP, Mr. Singhdeo was the youngest member of the Orissa Legislative Assembly, to which he was returned in 2004 as a representative of the Saintala constituency. Currently, Mr. Singhdeo is a member of the 15th Lok Sabha, representing Bulangur constituency in Orissa. Perhaps Mr. Singhdeo doesn't know that I know their family very well. I also know you have not mentioned, not only your father, your grandfather was the Chief Minister of Orissa. Wasn't he, R.N. Singhdeo? So I've been to your place also in Saraikala a number of times. So all the best to you. Thank you very much for being here. I would now request you to start the deliberation, followed by Mr. Sengupta. You can speak from there also. Yeah, you can speak from there.
Thank you, and thank you for calling me for this conference. It's been a wonderful conference so far. Are we politicizing our natural resources? In short, the answer is yes. We have always done so. Natural resources, not only in India, but across the world, have been politicized, have been the source of conflicts, and had been a source of wealth generation and development. Politicization of natural resources starts from the politics of ownership, politics of extraction, and politics of utility of those natural resources. When we talk of politics of ownership, we can connect to the Kuwait and Iraq wars over oil. When we talk of the politics of extraction, we come more to recent times with what we now term as the Coalgate scam, 2G, utility. Natural resources are governed by government policies. Politics will determine the utility of those resources. To expect that political parties will not bring in politics into the utilization of natural resources, I think is a futile exercise. To understand that politics will always revolve around natural resources is the first step for resolution of these conflicts. Let's look at the latest scam that we have, the Coalgate scam. X amount of captive mines given out to power producers. The CAG, an independent authority, has come up with a figure of 1,86,000 crores of loss to the exchequer. Now, I know a lot of you feel that's overinflated. I do too. However, nobody has talked about the fact that in many cases where power producers are under the PPA regime, these costs are normally a pass-through. Neither the media nor the beneficiaries of these allocations, nor the industry as a whole. In fact, the media has been instrumental in sensationalizing this scam. Political parties jump to the opportunity. They present an alternative to the current government. It is their job of the opposition to highlight the loopholes and the problems that is associated with government policies. Can we blame them for bringing it up? Can we blame the forest dwellers of Kalahandi for resisting the Vedanta project? Can we blame the tribals of Kalinganagar when they had initially resisted the Tata Steel project? Now, that's where political decisions come. Politicians and political parties have to take a position on the benefit or the SWOT analysis of these projects, cost-benefit ratio of these projects. Do we uproot 15,000 tribals and allow Vedanta to function, which gives 4,000 or 5,000 jobs, and which gives 2,000 or 3,000 crores into the state exchequer every year, money which can then further be redistributed to the poor of that area or to the poor of the state, or help in bringing better education, health facilities? Or do we give prominence to the lifestyle, the life mechanism of those 14,000 tribals in Kalahandi who think that that hill which contains the bauxite is holy? It provides them sustenance. It provides them a way of life which they don't want to leave. These are conflicts which exist. And I think the beginning of this conference very clearly spelled out the need for inclusive growth, the need for carrying a larger segment of society in developmental projects. Can we as corporates, most of you are corporates or associated with corporates, can we as corporates ever think that a higher spending of CSR involving a lot more people on the ground would actually benefit our project, would make our job easier? Can we as corporates think without governmental push, without governmental a danda on the head, as they call it, can we feel that we should really be redistributing our profits in mining areas, especially in these 5 or 6 years where you've had supernormal profits, where the price of iron ore, let's say, has gone from, what, $9 to $900. Can we think about a fairer system? I think these are the issues which we need to deal with when we set up a greenfield project in India today. It is not unusual that setting up greenfield projects in India today has become an extremely difficult task. As most of you would realize, that right from buying the land, to getting water allocation, to getting the actual mineral deposit, if you are in that business, has become a huge problem. Now, these extreme positions taken by various stakeholders, be it the business houses themselves, be it regulators, or be it the government, these are all often susceptible to irresolution, where the parties can't come to a solution on this whole matter. Politicians and politics revolves around popular will. Most political parties will go with any issue which gains them some popularity. So it's important that when projects such as power projects or others are conceived of or are actually put into the ground, they involve a larger cross-section of people, derive benefits to a larger section of people and carry the population along with them. Don't depend upon governments to the extent that you have in the past, where the government has actually acquired 5,000 acres of land for you. I think it's time when a more proactive approach to business is required. I think it's time when more involvement of the local population is necessary. A thing like land, which is not more than 1% of your project cost in a power project. Yet, the pricing of land, when you actually come into an agreement, is as minuscule as 1 lakh or 2 lakh rupees an acre. Can we not increase it to 4 or 5 lakhs? Will it really impact your project by raising costs by 0.5%? I think these are smaller issues which business houses and the people who are developing these projects, be it in the public sector or private sector, have to come up with. The second thing we need, I think, is a clear delineation of the regulatory network or the process and the laws which don't allow for political interference. Whenever you allow politics to get in the way of actually allocating or determining the process of allocation with a discretionary mode in it, I think you'll always have problems. I'll give you a small example. Recently, one of the business houses who had won the coal-based power plant, I was talking to a friend outside, and one of the UMPPs was bid for and won by them. When they discovered more coal, they set up another plant. Or they approached the government for another plant. The government, in its wisdom, approved that. However, another adversary of that company has gone to court about it. I think politics is also influenced largely by corporate wars. There is an element of opposition to projects which comes out of corporate adversaries. There is an element of encouragement of such matters. I think the other thing which will largely help in aligning or at least letting people know who or what is behind political positions is an openness of funding to political parties. I think if you can allow, or we as a nation should allow corporates to fund openly political parties, so people can judge for themselves as to which political party takes what position on which issue and where that's generated out of, whether it is a genuine concern of that political party or politician, or whether it is actually done on the basis of some lobby. I think that's probably my signal to stop. Lastly, I want to say, development and the concept of development, as we know, needs to have some sort of a relook. When we talk of development, we need to have a better understanding of what that development does for us. India's culture, or the politics of culture in India, is still, to a large extent in rural areas, reasonably socialistic, reasonably, I would say, encompassing of the need of basic necessities. And as we know, politics in India is determined largely from India's rural sector. So when we talk of putting projects in, despite the need for these development projects to come up, despite the need for electricity to be there, I think we need to have an attitudinal change as to how we approach them. Thank you.
Very good afternoon to all of you. I know that we are running short of time, so I will try and speed up whatever we can. At the outset, I would like to thank Harry for inviting me here to this wonderful seminar. I came in yesterday night And I think I spent a good part of the day today listening to various speakers. And it was indeed very impressive, very refreshing, because we from the industry hear only one kind of discussions when we are at work. So it was very nice to hear a whole section of different sections of society representing different kind of thoughts. So Hari, thank you for inviting me. I also know that you've undergone a kind of personal tragedy at your home. So I was very impressed that in the true spirit that show must go on, you've really done a wonderful job. My condolences as well as compliments for keeping the show going. Politicization of natural resources, I think this is a subject I would like to take on. While Kalikesh spoke about it from the political perspective, I'd like to speak about it from an industrial perspective. And I think at the end of it, as I was hearing him speak, I thought that there was no divergence in really the ideas that we are talking about. So it's a little curious, I couldn't understand really the dichotomy behind what is this whole story of politicization of national resources. Subjects are raised at various forums, subjects are discussed at various forums depending on what the situation would be. But if you really think back, step back and think about it, I think there is one perspective, one agenda that most of us, whether we are politicians or industrialists, are striving to drive. And towards that, I would like to draw your attention to the subject of mining, because that's what natural resources deals about in our perspective, which is steel and the mineral industry. In the world today, I think there are only two eternal truths and two eternal activities. One is around agriculture, because we need food, and everything is around growing food, developing it, packaging it, producing it to the Walmarts that we heard just now. And the other is around mining, because everything that you do starts with what resources you get from Mother Earth. Everything else that is there is around this whole business of converting it into a useful product for the people at large, and then presenting it, packaging it, advertising it, accounting for it, selling it. All of it are edifices which lie on this basic truth. So there are only two basic truths, basic activities as far as the world is concerned. One is around agriculture and the other is around mining. In India, while we have been, of course, agricultural for many, many years, but we started this business of metallurgy and industrialization, I think around 6,000 to 8,000 years ago. And we had some of the best practices, smelting practices, even from the very early years. The rust-free pillar at Delhi, which was built in the 4th century BC, is an evidence of that. Even today, as we go prospecting in some of the areas, iron-rich areas of Orissa and Jharkhand, do you see evidences of smelting which were done many, 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 many years ago? There is still an existing tribe which uses the old process of smelting that was prevalent in those times, from those times, and is still alive today. So therefore, mining has always been used. What, for what purpose? To create some implements, some things which help either to live your life or to do agriculture well. So these two are kind of symbiotic and always present when we think of human civilization. The other thing which is an eternal truth is that geology and Mother Earth knows no boundaries. There is no Orissa, there is no Jharkhand, there is no Karnataka. It's all geology. I mean, how does Mother Earth spread itself, and under what techniques and tools do we use in order to put these, to kind of take this or extract these minerals out, and how do we go about it? All the talk that we hear today about state boundaries and the issues around it are really things which are, I think, a little bit of, if I may use the word, a little bit of fictitious in nature. Because again, here there are two drivers. Where does the mineral occur? And second, what is the economics of that conversion so that it makes the business and the product cheapest and most affordable to the people? Many years ago, Tata Steel came to the area where it put up its plant, which was then not Orissa and not Jharkhand, but the state of Mayurbhanj. And it was Mr. Jain Tata who had this vision of creating the industrial India. He called it the industrial revolution, which was about creating India as an economic power. He made investments in three basic units, basic businesses, which is power, steel, and education. Power to power its industries, steel to build infrastructure for an independent and a strong country, and education to create the people to man these institutions so that India could run on its own and could stand on its own feet. And the person who invited him into Mayurbhanj was none other than the Raja of Mayurbhanj. So in a way, if you look back into history, one can say that the builders of modern industrial India, in a way, were Mr. Jain Tata and the Raja of Mayurbhanj. They created the pillars on which Indian economic revolution could actually happen. That's what history is all about. That's what geology leads us to. And that's how I think farsightedness of people help us to define what's really the purpose of the minerals that we have, not mere politicization. That does not help. If you look out even today, do we have an alternative to growth? We have debates in the parliament every day. We have reams and reams, and I think Suhail talked a little while ago about what we hear from the newspapers and the media and ownership and all the rest of it. But if we really question ourselves as Indians, do we have an alternative to growth? Would you like to live in can we live in cities? Can we live in an India which has no cities? Can we live in India where there's no electricity? Can we live in India where there are no gadgets? Can we live in India where there are no roads, bridges? Where did they all come from? After all, it is through this process of industrialization. Industry needs minerals, industries needs water, industries need air, and it needs the land to stand on. So therefore, what are we talking about? Unless we want to take back India into the prehistoric era, the hotel that we are sitting in, the lights that we are talking under the glare of, the television screens on which we are seeing ourselves, the food that you are eating outside is all thanks to industrialization. Even today, India's per capita steel consumption is one among the lowest in the world. We, with a billion plus people, consume less than 40 kilos of steel per capita. And so is the case with all other consumptions that we have. While surely we heard about the footprint of people, footprint. But on the other hand, if you want to spread your footprint in a kind of thoughtful way, and where to create infrastructure in a thoughtful way, these are a must for progress as we move along. How many of us would like to see our hard-earned foreign exchange being paid for bills for coal to power all our cities? We have been bringing in oil because we have none, but we have coal. Why were we not able to use the coal ourselves? Why are we not able to extract the coal and use it ourselves rather than being dependent on bringing it from outside for which we pay millions of dollars from our hard-earned foreign exchange? These are issues that we have to deal with. However, we must understand that minerals do overlap forests. They overlap river basins, they overlap tribal populations, and they overlap areas with low human development indexes, what we call as HDIs. This is the paradox, and this is the paradox of development. You can turn this argument anyway. You could make it, you could politicize it, or you could say that under one nation, you want to go ahead and develop it just like Mr. Jain Tata and Raja Mayurbhanj did several years ago. But as far as mineral extraction is concerned, and as far as development is concerned, the mantra is about inclusive growth and sustainable development. As Kalikesh talked about, how do you give the maximum benefit to the people all around? How do people benefit from your activities to the maximum extent is what it is all about. And if industry and people and miners and everybody were to think about translating the benefits of industrialization to the population of India at large, I think we have an answer. And we need no politicization to do that. I think we are responsible citizens as Indians. We well know our job, it's cut out well. And our mantra is nothing but sustainable development. Thank you very much.
I'm better with Jamshedpur.